Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel, welcome back to another video, and today we are doing a Witch Wednesdays. It's been a little while, but I am back, and for the first time we're taking a look at a relationship timeline from the comics rather than the TV show, and we are looking at the timeline of the relationship between Cornelia and Caleb. So, full disclosure before we get into it, I do not like the relationship between Cornelia and Caleb in the comics. It's so awkward for me because their TV counterparts are like my number one OTP of all time, but the comic version is just unbearable. But I am here to document witch lore and tell you about different aspects of the witch universe. And I certainly have a lot of thoughts on this one, so I'm going to talk about it, and you're in for a wild ride. So as always, let's introduce the players in this mess. So on one side, we have Cornelia Hale. She is a 14-year-old girl who lives with her wealthy family in the Garden Plaza apartment block in the city of Heatherfield. She seems cold and unfeeling on the surface, but underneath she has a big heart and she cares deeply about her friends and family. And within which, she is the Earth Guardian. She's very much viewed as this kind of prim and proper girl, kind of elegant lady, strong kind of moral compass, that kind of thing. On the other side, we have Caleb. Caleb is a murmurer or a whisperer. I don't know if that's a translation thing, but there doesn't seem to be a consistent name for what Caleb is. I've always known him as a murmurer because I think of whisperers as being like the plants from the TV show, the little flowers, whereas murmurers are like the full-size, like humanoid-looking plant people. That's the way I do it in my head. So for the consistency in this video, I am going to be calling him a murmurer. Murmurers are basically these plant people that were created by Phobos to serve him. In the comics, murmurers are the only ones who are permitted to see Phobos in person, and they all kind of gather around him and honestly, I don't really know what they do. Tell him that he's cool, brush his hair, help him bathe. I genuinely don't know. They're like his glam squad or something. But Caleb was different. He managed to gain sentience and break free from Phobos' control and become human-ish. We never really see how he manages to do this. Willpower, I guess. 10% luck, 20% skill, 15% concentrated power of will. Something like that. In any case, this turns him into a human looking creature with green stripes on his face. He looks completely human, but he has green stripes on his face, which they do say a couple of times in the series as moss. So that's fun. He's a man with a mossy face. Lovely. He then decides to launch a rebellion against Phobos, which makes sense considering Phobos created him to like live a life of indentured servitude. So you know, I would imagine that would piss you off. So he kind of rallies the people of Meridian to come together and overthrow their tyrannical prince. And that's where he's at when we meet him in issue 7. But before we get there, let's talk a little bit about an earlier issue. In the first few issues of the comic, we see the girls show interest in boys. It's stated in the first issue that Elyon has a crush on Matt. Will also then develops a crush on Matt in the second issue. Armour goes on a very ill-fated date with Andrew Hornby, but Cornelia doesn't really seem to have a romantic interest. That is, until she sees Tarani's brother Peter in the fourth issue. This scene hints that Cornelia is attracted to Peter, but we need to put this on the back burner because it is relevant, but not for a while yet. Other than that, Cornelia expresses no real desire for a romantic relationship in the first 6 issues. In fact, in promotional material, it's stated that Cornelia hates affairs of the heart, suggesting that she finds relationships messy and stressful and just prefers not to get involved in them. But of course, that all changes with issue 7, One Day You'll Meet Him. It is worth noting that between the creation of issue 6 and issue 7, the original creative team for Witch were removed from the project, which changed the direction of the story. You can see quite a significant shift in this installment. Originally, Elyon was supposed to remain a villain for the entire arc, and she is particularly cruel in the previous issue, and yet in this issue, she expresses regret for her actions and wants to change. if this realization feels like it came out of nowhere to you, it's kind of because it did. I don't think it's a coincidence that issue 7 is when this very over-the-top love story plot is introduced for Cornelia. It seems to be a product of the change of direction for the arc. But anyway, let's get into it. Cornelia's story in this issue starts with her tidying her bedroom when she finds her diary from the year before, which includes, honestly, the worst poem I've ever read. It's so terrible. It's a poem that Elyon wrote for her, and it goes, "You are nice, you are lively, you are the friend I like. You are nice, you are okay, stay the same." Which just, what? It says "you are nice" twice for a start. "You are the friend I like." And I really hope that by "you are okay" she means like you are safe, you are going to be okay, because otherwise it's like, you're okay, you're fine, I guess, you're passable, you're not the best, but you're all right, you'll do. It's so bad. I hate it. And I know she would have been like 13 at the time, but it sounds more like something that a 5-year-old would write. And it feels like it should rhyme as well, and it doesn't, and I don't know if that's a translation issue or not, but I just hate it. It's the worst poem ever. And the fact that Cornelia's emotional over it is so funny to me, because I'd be crying over how bad it is. But anyway, moving on, that's not what we're here to discuss. But this causes Cornelia to reminisce about her past friendship with Elyon, and she remembers a conversation that she and Elyon had after a skating competition, where she tells Elyon that she turned down a date with a boy named Pete because of the boy in her dreams. Cornelia goes on to tell Elyon that she can't be with anyone else but the boy from her dreams, that she only has one great love and that it's him. She will turn down any boy who comes to her because she's waiting to meet her dream boy. That's when Elyon presents Cornelia with a picture of the boy from her dreams. Now, how Elyon knows what Caleb looks like is a bit of a mystery. It's either that she's listened to Cornelia describe him so many times that she's essentially been able to create like a witness sketch like people do for criminals, or, and this is my headcanon and kind of sort of half, like, it's not confirmed, but it's speculated by Cornelia later in the series as well that this is what it is, that she subconsciously knows what Caleb looks like because she is also from Meridian. You know how in Twitches Cameron like would draw pictures of Coventry even though she hadn't been there since she was like a few hours old? Like that. And Cornelia goes on to suggest that this could be the case in issue 10, saying that Elyon's art basically creates a bridge between worlds. I also like that theory because, of course, Elyon does end up with Caleb later on in the series, so the idea that she created like an almost perfect sketch of him from her own subconscious is kind of more poetic and more romantic than the whole seeing him in her dreams thing with Cornelia. Like, to me, that feels like a much better sort of start for a relationship arc than whatever is going on with Cornelia and Caleb, but we'll get there. And it's certainly more poetic than that shit that she wrote in Cornelia's diary, dear God. The one difference in the drawing is that her picture doesn't have green stripes on its face like the real Caleb, which begs the question of whether he had the stripes in Cornelia's dream, and if so, why did Elyon not draw them, and why is Cornelia not questioning it? I mean, it would be weird to have a human boy with green stripes in his face, but also, why is Cornelia not... It's weird. I don't really get... We never see Cornelia's dream apart from some kind of, sort of, in the year before. So we don't really know what she saw in her dreams when she met Caleb. We never do find out, which is really great for the plot overall. Elyon tells Cornelia that she's sure that she will meet her dream boy one day, and Cornelia says that she wishes that that would happen. Well, get hype, because it's about to. Cornelia decides that she wants to go to Meridian and try to talk to Elyon to see if there's anything left of her former best friend. But none of the other girls want to risk going to Meridian and facing Elyon when it's likely she'll just attack them again. As a result, Cornelia decides to cross the veil into Metamor alone. She goes to the ye olde bookshop and bumps into Vathek, who has just recently defected to the good side. He says that he's there looking for items for someone named Caleb, and Cornelia has a very intense reaction to hearing this name, although she doesn't initially know why, but then it seems that she figures it out. Cornelia travels through a portal with Vathek, which brings them out in a fountain in the city. Cornelia panics because she can't swim, but luckily someone pulls her out of the water, and when she looks up, she finds herself staring into the face of that very boy from her dreams. Caleb tells the other rebels that he can vouch for Cornelia, and we later find out that's because he actually knows exactly who Cornelia is. But unfortunately, their meeting is cut short by one of the rebels yelling that the guards are coming. Caleb gives orders to his men and everyone scatters, with Caleb pushing Cornelia in front of him to get her to run. Cornelia spots Elyon and teams up with her to fight off the guards, and then the pair of them hole up in a house. Caleb enters and swears his and the rebellion's allegiance to Elyon and tells her that she is the light of Meridian. And then the three of them head back out. You'll notice that Elyon and Caleb have way more conversations in this issue than Cornelia and Caleb do. Curious that. Caleb makes this rousing speech about how the light of Meridian has returned, and Cornelia just kind of watches him with this look on her face. Also, someone at the side says that foreigner has made him lose his mind, which is kind of hilarious because all she's really said to him is like two words. Like, she's barely spoken to this boy, but apparently she's made him lose his mind. The guards turn up again, so Caleb tells everyone to run and hide just as the rest of the guardians show up. Everyone fights off the guards, and Cornelia has a heartfelt goodbye with Elyon, who is now firmly back on the guardian's side. And then Cornelia and Caleb finally get to speak to each other. This panel just makes me think of What Are You, an Idiot Sandwich, and I can't get the thought out of my head, and it absolutely ruins the scene. So yeah, Caleb has been dreaming of Cornelia too. We never do get any explanation as to how that works, it's just the power of love or something. He gives her a blue flower, which is a hilarious piece of foreshadowing, and tells her that if they are meant to be together, then they will be. I love that Tarani acknowledges Cornelia's total personality shift here. I mean, yeah, maybe she's just a hopeless romantic at heart, or just hopeless in this case. Or maybe the writers wrote in such a massive genre shift here that someone needed to call it out in the narrative. The issue then ends with Cornelia coming home in an unusually good mood and then sitting in her room staring at the flower with big heart eyes. Caleb is briefly in issue 8, but he's on Metamoor and Cornelia is on Earth and there's nothing to talk about there, so we'll move on to issue 9. In this issue, because the writers hate consistency, Cornelia is back having a crush on Peter. Peter speaks to her in the school hallway and Cornelia blushes. This sparks the Grumper sisters to mess with her and say that she and Peter would make a cute couple, but that Will has a crush on him too, and that Will told Peter that Cornelia would never go out with him. This causes a brief rift between the girls, but they quickly get over it. I do have to wonder though, if we're supposed to believe that Cornelia is so devoted to Caleb that he's her one true love and that she only wants him and that she'll never date anyone else because he is everything, why are the writers also pushing this Cornelia and Peter narrative? It's really weird and it kind of undermines that Cornelia and Caleb story. I'm not saying it's unusual to have a crush on more than one person at once, especially when you're a hormonal teenager, but it just doesn't make a lot of sense with what we've been told about Cornelia's feelings for Caleb. She literally says, "I want no one else but him," and yet here she's getting really annoyed about someone else having a crush on a boy that she likes at school. Which just does, those two things don't fit, they don't go together. Unless at this point she's thinking that she won't be with Caleb because he's on another planet, but I mean he gave her a magical teardrop flower promise thing? I don't know, I just find this really strange. Later in the issue, Tarani and Cornelia have a joint dream where Cornelia and Peter are presented as a couple, so make of that what you will. But yeah, Caleb isn't mentioned in this issue at all. Instead, Cornelia seems to be totally fixated on Peter, completely in contrast with what happened in issue 7. Who knows? Moving on. In issue 10, Cornelia runs into Peter again and becomes a babbling mess. She refuses to get in the car with Peter even though Tarani and Halen are both getting a lift. And it's clearly because she has feelings for Peter and she feels uncomfortable around him, and she goes into more detail on this on the next page. She claims here that she likes Peter but she loves Caleb, and then calls Caleb her one true love and says that they fell in love at first sight. If you say so, Corny. I mean, I did not see that, but if you say so. But that's all we really get for issue 10. It's issue 11 before we see Caleb again. The girls go to Meridian and discover that it's the day of Elyon's coronation. Caleb and Vathek are in the crowd, watching events unfold. Phobos, of course, tries to steal Elyon's power, but the guardians have tricked him and the real Elyon is in the crowd with them. Caleb busts out his sword to fight Phobos and gets to say a quick hello to Cornelia. Will goes to fight Phobos, but Caleb intervenes and says that the prince is his, and then we get this wonderful exchange. A murmur with a will of its own is a mistake, and mistakes must be remedied, is 100% what Andrew and Daryl said when they sat down to plan out the TV show, and they are so real for that. Cornelia sees that Caleb is being attacked and tries to help, but Will pushes her out of the way. Well, Cornelia is real and you will never change my mind. Caleb is still fighting Phobos and we get this scene. This is the first of many times that Caleb gets zapped, that this becomes a real recurring theme for him. And remember that blue flower that Caleb gave to Cornelia? Well, yeah, now he is that flower. RIP in pieces kebab. Cornelia is heartbroken that the boy that she's spoken to exactly three times now has been turned into a plant, and Vathek tries to give some philosophical speech that Caleb is free now, which... How? How? Vathek? How? How? Okay. Caleb is still a flower in issue 12, but we get a few moments of Cornelia crying about it. She's down bad crying at the gym, I don't know what to tell you. I have to laugh at Will though. Losing Caleb is painful for all of us. You don't even know Caleb. You met him for a grand total of like 10 minutes. Is everyone here very stoned? Like... Later, Cornelia gives Flower Caleb to Vathek for safekeeping, but she says that she wants him back once they've defeated Phobos. She also gets really angry at Irma later in the issue for joking around, which we can assume is because she's like really pissed off at Phobos for zapping Caleb and she's got a personal score to settle with him. And also he tried to kill her best friend. I imagine that's probably like bugging her as well. She's not really president of the Phobos fan club at this point, let's put it that way. Anyway, the girls go with Elyon to confront Phobos and they fight Cedric's terrifying Super Saiyan form, and then they visit Kanjikar and meet the Oracle. And then they all head back to Earth and Cornelia takes her plant boyfriend home with her. Now the fun really starts. But before we get into Arc 2, we have a moment from a special to look at. During Cornelia's section of the Year Before special, she follows a mysterious voice outside and ends up talking to some trees. In amongst the vegetation, she sees a face formed out of leaves saying that she will know them and to trust them. And we can see that this is Caleb's face. This does beg the question of whether every time Cornelia saw Caleb in her dreams that he was a floating face made out of leaves. And if so, girls, seek help. What is wrong with you? Although she does say, I know you, so I guess that implies that she's seen him before. And I mean, I assume he wasn't always a pile of foliage because Elyon drew a picture of him in a human form, but it's weird. R2 opens with Cornelia being horribly depressed about Caleb, and it's stated that she hasn't been in school for 2 days. Her friends come to visit, but she's distant and dismissive. She tells the girls that this is due to Elyon being on Metamor and Caleb being gone. I actually quite like this page. It's not surprising that Cornelia is having a bit of a crisis, being that her best friend is gone and the boy that she thinks that she loves is basically dead. The girls try to encourage her to move on, but Irma puts it as indelicately as possible. But the thing is, she's completely right, and the story itself will prove that. But in the words of Marge Simpson, she's right, but she shouldn't say it. Cornelia kicks the girls out of her apartment and goes back to crying into her pillow. Will buys Cornelia a pet cat to try and cheer her up, but Cornelia is dismissive of this too and gives the cat to Lillian, who names him Napoleon. Later in the issue, Tarani and her brother are captured by Frost, and Tarani telepathically calls her friends and tells them that they need to go to Cornelia, but Cornelia is still having a bad time at home. Lillian and Napoleon are playing in her room and winding her up. She says that she just wants to be alone, and when the rest of the girls turn up, she pretends not to be home. That spooks the girls as they assume that she's being captured by Frost, but later they see her at the door and realise that she must have lied to them and she's deliberately avoiding them. So the girls have to go fight Frost without her, all because she's upset about Caleb. In issue 14, Cornelia is still in a depresso espresso in her room, and according to Irma, Cornelia hasn't left the house since Caleb became a flower. As such, Cornelia is totally unaware that the other four guardians have lost their powers and she is the only one who still possesses them. Instead, she's sniffing flower Caleb. This is so weird to me every time I read it. I'm like, what do you mean you can smell his perfume? What, is he wearing Britney Spears Fantasy? What are you talking about? Is he wearing Daisy? Like, what are you talking about? You can smell his perfume. Shut up. Cornelia has dinner with her family, but an argument erupts between her and her mother over Cornelia's current attitudes. And then everyone hears a crash coming from Cornelia's room. Cornelia runs in to see Flower Caleb on the floor, surrounded by broken glass, and she assumes that Napoleon knocked the vase over. Off topic, but this orange dress is my favourite thing that Cornelia has ever worn. It's so pretty. Also, Cornelia must have such supportive parents. Like, they don't even judge her for having a breakdown over her plant, and they have no idea that he used to be a person, which is really sweet of them. I mean, I've had worse breakdowns over more innocuous things when I still had periods, so maybe they just think she has severe PMS. She is 14. This incident knocks Cornelia out of her funk, and she decides that she's going to contact her friends and go back out into the real world. The girls are heading to her apartment when Cornelia hears another crash, but this time she sees the culprit. It wasn't Napoleon. It was a crow trying to peck at Flower Caleb, and Napoleon was chasing it away, which causes Cornelia to cry with joy. Then Cornelia sees Will in the doorway, but this isn't the real Will. It's a changeling being that has been stealing all the girls' power, and Cornelia has just thrown her arms around it. But the changeling doesn't steal Cornelia's power. Instead, Cornelia absorbs the power of all five elements. She now has the power of all five guardians combined, and it quickly goes to her head. She throws her friends out of the apartment again, telling them that she never wants to see them. And then she resolves to use her new power to bring Caleb back to life. The girls head to Cornelia's apartment, but she isn't answering the door. And this is because she's inside trying to use her powers to resurrect Caleb, but it isn't working. And her antics are concerning the Council of Kanjikar. Luba tries to convince the council that the guardians are too immature and cannot be trusted with their powers. Back at her apartment, Cornelia is still trying to resurrect Caleb and it's still not working, and the council fear that her new power may consume her. Cornelia tells Plant Caleb that she's never felt so powerful and that she won't give up. But then, Luba turns up in Cornelia's apartment and tells her to stop, that what she's doing is forbidden and that she can't use her magic to bring a monster back to life. Cornelia takes this about as well as you would expect. I love this though. Luba demands to know how that Cornelia could challenge Kanjikar's authority, and Cornelia replies, "You used us to defeat Phobos. Where were you?" So true, bestie. Roast Kanjikar. Bunch of old twats using teenage girls as pawns in their schemes. May they only know pain. Cornelia explodes in a fit of rage. After nearly destroying her apartment, she continues trying to resurrect Caleb, whilst Luba yells at her and waves Jack Frost's staff about in the background. But this time, it kind of works. There is something happening to the plant, but Luba won't stand for this, and the last thing that Tarani sees as she comes bursting into the apartment is Cornelia, Luba, and a plant monster disappearing into the ether. In Kanjikar, Cornelia looks at what she has created. She has resurrected Caleb, but not into his human form. Instead, she's returned him to being a murmurer, which is probably worse than being a plant, honestly. Caleb hated being a murmurer. He used all of his strength to evolve out of that form. But now here he is, murmurer again, and it's all Cornelia's fault. Luba yells at Cornelia and tells her that Caleb was never real. He was always just a murmurer and he will always be just a murmurer, and that Cornelia needs to accept that. But first, she will need to answer to the council for what she has done. Cornelia refuses to accept this though, and she sits with Caleb trying desperately to get through to him. And then she starts crying, and lo and behold, her teardrops are magical. Because remember, it's not a teardrop, it's a promise. To be fair, the way the writers connected that is very clever, but I still hate it because it's these two. It's impossible to like anything that these two do. Anyway, Cornelia and Caleb have this big scene where he tells her that he could hear her the whole time that he was a plant, and that she was the reason that he never gave up hope that he would come back, and she's beautiful, and they're going to face the council together because love is the most powerful magic of all, and then they kiss. Bear in mind, this is only the fourth conversation these two have had outside of their dreams, which we never see or know anything about. So I'm simply not buying that they are this much in love, although I'm sure that Caleb does appreciate how hard she tried to bring him back and how much she risked in doing so, and I suppose that's pretty romantic. I find it hard to believe that there's this much depth of feeling between the two of them when, like, literally they've only had four conversations, and they've been very brief conversations up until now. And it's not even as if you can say that, like, they must have met up off page sometime, because this is literally, there is no chance of that. That's literally impossible with the timeline. These really are the only four times that they've ever met in person. Canonically, that is all there is. So, yeah, I find it hard to invest in this. But anyway. Meanwhile, that this is all going on, the council are back in the main room of the fortress arguing over whether Cornelia is a hero or a monster. I have to say, funny she simply appears to be in love, or funny she appears to just be a girl in love, depending on your translation. I think that's such a good line, and I love it, because it's true. Cornelia wasn't trying to bring back a monster and, like, bring an evil presence into Kandrakar. She was just trying to give this person, who she knew was a person, like, he had been a person, she was just trying to give him his life back and save him from eternity as a flower. And you can argue that we shouldn't interfere with fate like that, but you can argue that she had any bad intentions. This was 100% a selfless, heroic act that she was performing. Luba wants to invoke the Kandran, which means that they will choose five new guardians. But when the rest of which turn up to get their powers back, the Oracle denies the Kandran. Caleb steps forward and says that he is willing to accept the punishment on Cornelia's behalf and that he will stay on Kandrakar as their servant. The council agrees to this. And Caleb's first job as the Herald of Kandrakar is to go and get Luba back, because she's just ran off onto another planet or something. She noped right out of there. She was having none of it. She hates these girls. She's off. She's leaving. And this means, of course, Caleb is once again leaving the narrative to go off and do something else. And yeah, he's been back for exactly five pages and he's off again. Who wrote this? How are we supposed to be invested in this relationship when they're never in the same room for more than like two pages at a time? It's ridiculous. Why is this relationship written like this? How was this the epic love story of the series? It's so bad. Oh, okay. So Cornelia and Caleb say goodbye to each other again, and Caleb waves the guardians off as they go back to Earth. Back in Heatherfield, things really just go back to normal, and in the original version of this issue, Irma makes this comment about Cornelia changing her perfume now that she has a boyfriend, although the Yen Press version decided to change it and make it something about her being on the prowl, which is just weird. Stop it, Yen Press. Stop. There are quite a few moments in the Yen Press versions where I very much raise my eyebrows. I'm just like, girl, what? Don't Close Your Eyes is actually one of my favourite issues, and it's a very interesting one for Cornelia and Caleb. Let's get into it. So the girls are all heading home from their holiday at Cormoran Beach with Irma's family, and Harold Hale is driving Cornelia and Will home. Will is talking about her nightmares and about Matt, which are basically the same thing, but never mind that. Will says she feels like Matt is so far away and the absence doesn't make the heart grow fonder, which immediately sets Cornelia off because obviously her love is much farther away than Heatherfield, and she just promptly bursts into tears and calls love a rare disease, and Will hugs her. And we are reminded once again that Will and Cornelia are the true OTP of this series, and I will die on that hill. You should not be shipping anything but them. I'm sorry, that is the truth, that is the rules. Will and Cornelia is canon. You will never convince me otherwise. In some cave somewhere, Nerissa... Oh, right, yeah, Nerissa's the main villain now. Don't ask questions, never mind. It's not important. Nerissa sets her sights on capturing Caleb because he has a copy of all the Guardian's power from Cornelia bringing him back to life. Cornelia and her family head up to Riddlescott Lake for a family holiday, and Will goes home. But then, a mysterious man turns up at her door. What do you know? It's Caleb! How can he ride a motorbike when he comes from a medieval world with no cars or gas or electricity? Unimportant! Don't ask questions! The writers didn't care to explain it, so why should I? Caleb says that Cornelia is in danger and that the woman who is claiming to be her mum's friend is actually Luba in disguise. He also says that he can't get close to Luba because she can sense him, so Will will need to go to Cornelia and warn her instead. This is the only issue of the entire first two arcs where we see any sort of personality from Caleb, which is nice in one sense, but ridiculous in another. But his lines about having to ride the bus are very funny. It's also another issue where Caleb has more interactions and chemistry with one of Cornelia's friends than he ever actually has with her. Honestly, the bond between Caleb and Will is far more obvious here than his bond with Cornelia, and she has met him on her own once before, back in issue 8, so there is a precedent for them having a friendship, and yeah, it's almost as if every other character in this series would make a better pairing with Caleb than Cornelia. It's crazy, it's really strange. So Caleb and Will ride the bus to Riddlescott Lake, and they have a battle of wits with a kid, whatever, it's not important. He makes a comment about how hard it is to be separated from the people you care about, but that's really it. But he does get this line about what life unites, destiny divides, which comes up again later. The pair arrive at Riddlescott Lake and Will goes to get Cornelia, and then she shows her how she got to the lake. Now, I want you to look at this page. Like, really look at it. Take it in, process it, observe it with your eyes, okay? Just in case you need help, I'll explain what we're looking at, just so you know what we're taking in with our eyes, with our optics here. This is Caleb, right? We know Caleb. Tall, dark, green stripes. That's Caleb. And this is Cornelia. We can see that it's Cornelia. It's Cornelia in her regular form. She doesn't have wings. She isn't super tall with a green and purple outfit on. This is just regular old Earth girl Cornelia. All right? We got that? Good. File that away in your brain for now, because we will come back to it. Anyway, Caleb gets zapped again because that is his entire role in this series at this point. Nerissa's Knights of Revenge show up, Shaegon grabs Caleb, Cornelia tries to protect him but it doesn't work, and Shaegon disappears with Caleb, and Cornelia collapses to the ground in tears because what life unites, destiny divides. So just to recap, just in case you need a little, you need someone to track this for you. We met Caleb in issue 7. He appeared briefly in issue 8, then in issue 11 he got turned into a flower. In issue 15 he became a person again, then left to become the Herald of Kandrakar. He came back in this issue, got captured again, and disappeared again. He has been in 5 issues. Five. And he's only been face to face with Cornelia in 4 of them! How am I supposed to believe that this is some epic world-shifting love? How? It's ridiculous, and it only gets worse from here on in. Issue 18 begins with Halen announcing that she has met a boy and all the girls wanting to hear the details. After Halen tells the story, we then get a page asking how the girls could have forgotten Caleb. We then flash back to Kandrakar after Caleb was taken by Shaegon in issue 17. The Oracle explains that the Knights were working for Nerissa and that the Guardians are not capable of stopping her. Cornelia yells at the Oracle, as she should because he's a twat, saying that after all the battles that they've fought for Kandrakar, they should at least be granted permission to save their friend. And honestly, I cannot disagree with her. Like, as much as I don't like Caleb, I cannot disagree with that logic. They have powers, they should be able to use them to rescue the people that they love, especially when it's people who have sworn their allegiance. Like, he's literally working, he's the Herald of Kandrakar. Like, he promised that he would serve Kandrakar, and the Oracle's just left him in the clutches of a madwoman with insane power. Fuck the Oracle. But of course the Oracle refuses and sends the girls home before clouding their memories to prevent them from trying to save Caleb. I hate him. I hate the Oracle so much. I get that they aren't strong enough, but this is not the way to deal with it. You can't just remove people's memories when they're an inconvenience to you. Fuck off, Himmerish. I hate you so much. We then see what Caleb is currently experiencing whilst the Oracle does fuck all to help him. And look, I don't like Caleb, but he does not deserve this. This looks like absolute hell. Literally, it looks like he's in literal Satan's living room. He does not deserve this. He's not done anything to deserve this, okay? He's boring. He doesn't deserve to be burning in the fiery pits of hell. This is a shame. This is not fair. Caleb manages to escape the cave and wanders out into the frozen wilderness, where he collapses at the feet of a cloaked figure. And it turns out to be of all people, Luba. And in the twist of the century, she decides to help him. Cornelia has a dream about someone being in pain, but she can't recall the details clearly. Luba tells Caleb that she wishes that Cornelia could hear his words, but that she can't remember him right now. But then, the girls regain their memories of what happened, and Cornelia is horrified to realise that she has abandoned Caleb. So the Guardians head to Kandrakar once more to question the Oracle about what the fuck he is doing. This time, the Oracle tells them to go and save Caleb. So they do, and we get this panel of Cornelia holding his face whilst Luba smiles, which is kind of sweet, honestly. Like, it's nice. It's nice to see Luba's support in their relationship now after everything. Caleb puts his arm around Cornelia's shoulders, and she helps him out of the cave or whatever they are. And then Cornelia cries, saying that she thought that love was stronger than magic, and she's furious at herself for forgetting Caleb. And then the Oracle tells the girls that Caleb will remain in Kandrakar to heal, and the issue ends, and once again, Caleb is out of the narrative for now. Because of course he is. He went off. He got turned into a flower. He came back. He got sent off on a mission. He came back. He got taken by Shaegon. He came back. And now he's going into the cosmos of Abion's. The boy cannot be in the story for more than two pages at a time. I'm sorry, it's clearly this is the rules. I cannot do anything with it. Moving on to issue 19. At school, the girls discuss what happened in Kandrakar, and Cornelia again expresses her frustration at having forgotten Caleb and questions if magic is stronger than love. Basically, she feels like if she loves Caleb so much, then a spell shouldn't have been able to mess with her memories of him, but it did, so clearly there's something wrong with how much she loves him, and love isn't as powerful as she thought, because Caleb told her that love is the most powerful thing of all, but it obviously isn't. Or maybe your relationship with him is just shit, I don't know. Like, it depends, Cornelia, like, it depends, because you're not actually in love with Caleb, so it's hard to tell if love's more powerful than magic, girl. Tell me when you're with Peter, I don't know. I'm so mean. Later in the issue, the girls fight Nerissa and their dreams and become trapped in a magical dollhouse that isn't what it seems. Cornelia hears Caleb's voice behind a door, but it's a trick and she gets attacked. And that's really all there is for this issue. So, let's move on to issue 21. So Caleb has been in the cosmos of Abion's, or the Obliminos cosmos, depending on what you're reading. Since the whole Nerissa debacle. But he has now woken up, and when the Guardians arrive in Kandrakar, Caleb and Cornelia are reunited, and the pair of them kiss. Cornelia claims that she could die from happiness, which is really given Wesley and Buttercup from The Princess Bride, you know, like the whole, you're alive, if I could I would fly, like that's what it's giving, except that I actually like Wesley and Buttercup, unlike these two. And Irma thankfully and rightfully points out that Cornelia claiming that she would die of happiness is really stupid. On the next page we see them holding hands, whatever. But then out of nowhere, out of the clear blue sky of the heart of infinity itself, Cornelia suddenly has doubts about their relationship. Miss, I have one great love. I want no one else but him. I thought love was stronger than magic. I can't believe I forgot Caleb. Is now all of a sudden thinking that they won't work out. Where the heck did that come from? Well, I can tell you where. And it's time for some witch history. Or witch story, if you like. Or maybe not. So way back when the comics were first published in Italy, there was a poll in an ARC 2 issue asking fans to vote on whether they wanted Cornelia and Caleb to stay together or to break up. And the response was that they should break up. Now, I see two different ways that this could have played out for the writers. One, they had already planned to break Cornelia and Caleb up and were using a poll as evidence that it was the right move. In this version of events, I feel the poll results may have not been accurate. They might have been, I don't know. But what I do know is that Disney has put out polls in the past before where the responses are meaningless, like the time that they did a poll on the Disney Channel website to vote for which Hannah Montana actor should get a cameo in High School Musical 2 when the movie was already being filmed and they were already going to use Miley Cyrus. Realistically, there was no chance of anyone else winning the poll anyway, but it still felt very disingenuous. So I feel like either A, the response really was for them to break up, or B, it wasn't, but they claimed that it was to be like, look, you guys asked for this, don't get mad at us. Or two, the poll was 100% genuine, but the writers fully expected it to go the other way and were shocked when it came back that they should break up. And then, as a result, the writers had to very quickly change the plan for the rest of the arc and have Cornelia and Caleb end their relationship, which led to this ridiculously fast change in opinion from both of them. I'm not sure which version is true, although considering how quickly both characters went from we are in love and we are soulmates and love is the most powerful magic and we're going to be together forever, to I'm not sure about us, it kind of feels like the latter, and that's further evidenced when we see Caleb's reasoning for becoming unsure of their relationship. We see that Cornelia's doubts come from her trying to imagine how Caleb would fit into her life on Earth. She wants to introduce him to her family, but how will she explain his green stripes? She wants him to attend school with her, but how would he cope with that when he has no Earth knowledge to use for his studies? In any case, she says she wants him to know the real her. The herb that she has back home in Heatherfield. And that's when things become very, very stupid. Cornelia transforms back into her human form and Caleb is visibly shocked by it. He wonders if this is the real her when she is so different from the Cornelia that he knows. Cornelia asks if he doesn't recognize her without her wings, and Caleb goes on to say that he doesn't know what their future holds. Cornelia says that their future is together, but Caleb isn't sure. He says that he's a warrior, that he can't be anything else. Cornelia gets defensive and says that she's not some wussy girl and doesn't need him to protect her. If you want to play the White Knight, knock yourself out, Caleb, but don't expect me to play the damsel in distress. I love that line so much. Tattoo it on my face. It's so good. It's so good. So we see that Caleb's doubts about seeing a bit. So we see that Caleb's doubts about their relationship stem from seeing Cornelia in her real human form for the first time. Except it's not the first time, is it? So remember earlier in issue 17 when I told you to really study the panel with your eyes and then memorize it because we would come back to it later? Well, it's later and we're coming back to it. The narrative here wants us to believe that Caleb is shocked at seeing Cornelia in her human form and that the realization that she is human and not always this powerful magical creature with wings has scared him and made him question if they can really be together. Tarani even says that now he's seen the real her, it looks like Caleb is pulling back. But he had already seen the real her weeks ago. We see Cornelia in her human form with Caleb in issue 17. And I suppose you could try to argue that they only saw each other for a few seconds and that Caleb was so overcome with love that he didn't notice the dramatic height difference and the fact that she looks totally different before he got zapped. But this doesn't work either because he spent the whole day running around with Will, who was also in her human form. He was with her for hours. And he was on Earth with a bunch of other Earth people. He was on the bus. He was in the bus station. He saw all these Earth people and what they look like. He went to Will's house, so he knows that they live there. He expresses no surprise at seeing Will or Cornelia in their human forms. So he must know full well that the Guardians are not permanently in their Guardian forms, and he knows that their real form is their younger, smaller version. He knows what human beings from Earth look like because he spent the whole day running around there and expressed no surprise at the way that they are. He already knew all of this. So his reasoning for becoming doubtful of the relationship with Cornelia makes no sense. He shouldn't be shocked. He already knew the real her. Ah! It infuriates me. Oh my god. And so I think what happened behind the scenes was that the writers had to change direction quickly after the results of the poll came back, causing them to have to think of a reason for Cornelia and Caleb to break up, and they either forgot that he'd already seen her human form, or they hoped that we had forgotten that. But what really gets me is that they didn't need to use this as a reason. They already had a perfectly good reason. They just don't work. Their relationship is built on nothing, and they have no real connection. Having them realise this would have been such a better resolution than this. And it would have prevented Caleb from going on to become one of the most hated characters in the series for breaking up with Cornelia seemingly for the most shallow reason ever. Because she isn't as pretty in her human form. That's how it comes across. It's all based on looks, that she looks smaller, she doesn't have wings. Which is terrible, and it's really hard to forgive him for that. And I know many, many people in the fandom who never have. And what's even more bizarre is that they later released a special issue titled Cornelia and Caleb, A Love Not Meant to Be, which we will get to later, which explored why Cornelia and Caleb's relationship never could have worked. And it has nothing to do with Caleb realizing that Cornelia doesn't always have her gaydish outfit and wings. It's because they come from two different planets, and the only way their relationship could work is if one of them sacrificed their life on their homeworld to be with the other, which ultimately just made them both miserable. That makes total sense, but that's not what we get here. Instead, we get this nonsense. At this point in the issue, Nerissa attacks Kandrakar. Caleb wants to fight her, but the Oracle says he's not ready. Caleb doesn't accept this and says that the Oracle cannot stop him, so the Oracle relents and lets him go. Then Cornelia comes running over and apologizes to Caleb and begs him to come back safe. I don't know what girlie's apologizing for, but whatever. Caleb promises that he will return to her and then they will discuss their future. We then see Cornelia looking sad and the narrator wondering if love can survive every challenge. We also get this arc of human Cornelia reaching for Caleb and him shrugging her off whilst the flower falls from her hand. It's so good. I love this. And shout out to her outfit here. It was the one that's repurposed in the show into her O's for Obedience outfit, which is my favourite outfit she ever wore in the show. So this means a lot to me. This is a lot for my heart. We now move on to issue 22, The Broken Heart, which is one of my favourite issues of the whole series, and I'll always be a little bitter that it wasn't adapted for the show in any way because it's so good. And I actually think it would have worked better in the show, but I'll go off on a tangent about that later. At the start of the issue, we see Will telling Caleb to help Cornelia fight Shaegon. Although the Guardians and Caleb end up getting trapped in a floating cube before this can happen. The heart of Kandrakar shatters and unleashes pure evil into Kandrakar, and we see Cornelia and Caleb together on this page. And then suddenly, we're back on Earth, with Will. So, I'll quickly explain what the story is here. The girls wake up on Earth and find that their powers are gone and they no longer feel magical. At first, everyone is concerned by this, and the fact that they just disappeared from Kandrakar whilst Nerissa was flooding the place with evil, but then, one by one, they all become distracted. Halen sees Eric and suddenly stops worrying about her grandmother. Irma goes chasing a new guy. Tarani kisses Nigel in front of her mother, which is iconic, but not really the priority in that moment. Will and Cornelia are concerned about the others, but they're also starting to feel weird. Cornelia gets off at the wrong stop due to brain fog. Girl, I feel you. That is relatable. And that scene, so me. Will says they need to snap the girls out of it, but then Matt rides up in his bicycle. And suddenly Will loses her senses as well, and this leaves Cornelia as the only one with a fairly clear head, and she starts to worry that she'll forget her mission, and Caleb. Cornelia goes to Cadmus' house where she learns that Kandrakar no longer exists, and that the Guardians are forgetting that it ever did. She explains this to the other girls, but it's too late. They have no memory of ever being Guardians. You may have realised that the forgetting seems to be triggered by the girls seeing their crushes slash boyfriends, and that should put Cornelia in a strong position, right? Since she's not exactly likely to run into Caleb in the streets of Heatherfield. But of course, Caleb isn't the only boy that Cornelia has feelings for. When she bumps into Peter, she panics and runs off. And then we get this incredible page, which my tween self drew like 20 different times with varying degrees of quality. I'm sure I still have some of them. Cornelia's memories of Caleb start fading and are replaced with Peter. She runs home trying desperately to hold on to her memories of Caleb and of being a Guardian, and that's when she realises she does have one thing that proves that Kandrakar was real, that Metamur was real, and that the Guardians were real. That picture that Elion drew of Caleb. She goes to her drawer and pulls out the picture, which prevents her from forgetting. It's really cute, actually. I love this issue. And boom! With that, the girls are back in Kandrakar, which never actually disappeared, it was just an illusion spell. But Cornelia broke through the spell with her love for Caleb. And then we see her touching Caleb's face in this panel. Now, if you'll indulge me for a few minutes, I want to go off on a tangent. I really love this issue. I think it's such an interesting concept. It's such a clever plan from Nerissa, not just to remove the girls' powers, but to have them forget that they were ever guardians in the first place. That's genius, because it prevents them ever trying to get their powers back. You've won at that point. The guardians are not going to be an issue for you anymore because they have no idea that they're supposed to be. That's such a Nerissa thing to do, and I love it. That said, I do have a few criticisms. For a start, I think it's over too quickly. It's a great idea for a story, but it feels like it isn't properly utilised. There are a lot of things in the comic like this where the concept is better than the execution. The idea sounds really good on paper, but when it comes to the actual printed issue, it falls a bit flat. I mean, here, Cornelia discovers that the girls have forgotten Kandrakar, runs home, looks at her picture of Caleb, and then they're back in Kandrakar. We don't even have time to digest the fact that the girls have lost their memories of being guardians before they get them back again. It's a shame. The second is that I just don't feel that Cornelia and Caleb's love is strong enough to warrant this story. Like, when I read it, I see it the way I just explained it, that the picture of Caleb proves that Kandrakar and the guardians existed, and that breaks the spell. But the narrative clearly wants us to interpret it as, oh my god, she loves him so much that it broke the spell, epic love Shakespeare could never. And I just don't see it that way. I mean, if she loved him so much, her memories of him wouldn't be getting replaced with Peter, would they? If she was all in for Caleb, she wouldn't keep getting distracted by her feelings for Peter. It's such a mess. But yeah, indulge me for a moment because I want to tell you why I think this would have made a really good episode of the show. I don't know where it would have gone, somewhere in season 2, but here's my idea. The girls all wake up on Earth with no powers. At first they're concerned, but as the day goes on, their memories become clouded. We're taking out the whole seeing your crush triggers it thing because that just doesn't sit right with me. I don't think it makes the girls look very good. It implies that they're such a bunch of boy crazy maniacs that they lose all sense of reality from just seeing their boyfriend's faces. Or in Irma's case, just some random guy that she's never even met before. It's really bad. So the girls start questioning each other, saying things like, I feel like we were supposed to be somewhere, but I can't remember. Eventually, they completely forget that they were ever guardians. And for most of the girls, that poses no issue. They go back to their normal lives as if nothing has happened. But not Cornelia. Because even though she has no memory of the guardians, Cornelia has this deep-rooted sense that something is missing. Someone is missing. Because, of course, removing magic from her life doesn't just take away her powers, it takes away her people, Caleb and Elyon. And so she can feel this great loss, this huge hole in her life where something used to be, but no one else knows what she's talking about. I feel like what eventually would happen is she's talking to the girls and someone is being sarcastic, probably Irma, and Cornelia says, through pure muscle memory, haha, you sound like Caleb. And then it snaps in her brain. And she would be like, oh my gosh, Caleb, Elyon, Meridian, we forgot. And that's what would break the spell. And I think that would work because you're still getting the Cornelia brought back Kandrakar through the power of love thing. Except it feels genuine here. Unlike in the comic where they have this surface level fairy tale nonsense. In the show, they actually have a deep connection, a real bond. They are fiercely in love. So you would believe that Cornelia wouldn't fully lose her memories of Caleb because he means too much to her, and she can save them all through her love for him. And I think that would have made a great episode, and I'm sad we never got it. But it's real to me. It exists in my brain, and that is what matters. Anyway, thank you for indulging me. Let's get back to the issue. The girls go on to defeat Nerissa, and the issue ends with Cornelia and Caleb holding hands, looking worried, while the Oracle says that there are questions that even he cannot answer. Alright, troops, buckle in, put your helmets on, because it's time to say goodbye. The issue opens with these lovely pieces of art of Cornelia and Caleb, which props to the artist, they look great. We open in Kandrakar where, as the narrator puts it, a battle continues. A secret, silent fight that Cornelia is not sure that she will win. There's a lot to go through here, so just bear with me. The conversations are also quite different between the original English translation and the Yen Press edition, so I'm going to take a look at both because I do like both sets of dialogue here. Caleb asks Cornelia to listen to him, and says that he's been thinking. He says that Cornelia knows how much he cares about her, about their connection and the pain that they've endured. Cornelia tries to say that that pain is over now, but Caleb says that he isn't sure. He's going back to Meridian, and for both their sakes, he's not going to ask her to come with him. Now, in fairness, I'm not sure when there was ever a suggestion that Cornelia was going with him. Like, girlie has school. She has a family and a life. What do you mean I won't ask you to come with me? She wasn't coming with you anyway, pal. Shut up. But Cornelia is shocked by this and says that he's dumping her without giving her a say, which always makes me laugh. If someone breaks up with you, that's kind of it. You don't really get a say. If they don't want to be with you anymore, that's the end of the discussion. Unless you're Chrissy Teigen, who allegedly would not allow John Legend to break up with her and that's how they're married. But I think that's the exception to the rule. Generally, someone tells you that they're breaking up with you and that's the end of that discussion. Caleb says that they're too different, but Cornelia doesn't agree. Caleb says that they can't keep living like this, and Cornelia asks where this is coming from. In the end press version, she asks why he was fine being with her when she saved his life, but he's now changed his mind. In the original English, she asks if something happened in the cosmos of Abion's to change his mind, and I think both are fair questions. Like, I'm not saying you have to stay with someone forever just because they saved your life at one point. Like, I'm not saying if you had a heart attack and someone gave you CPR that you're then, like, bound to them for the rest of your life. Selena Gomez and the kidney. But he really is giving her absolutely no credit or appreciation for the fact that she almost destroyed the universe to bring him back from plant form. He's just fobbing it off as if their entire relationship meant nothing. Which, like, it kind of didn't, but saving his life did mean something. He wouldn't be able to break up with her if he was still a blue flower in a vase. He should be grateful that he has a mouth to dump her with. And I think the cosmos of Abion's question is valid too. He was in there to heal. But did he also spend that time thinking of reasons to end it with her? Caleb says that he still feels endless affection for her, and Cornelia replies, "I thought we were in love," which honestly breaks my heart. It's such a slap in the face to her. She thought they had this epic love story, and he's saying that he just kind of likes her. It's brutal. Caleb says that he didn't mean to hurt her, and she says that he's doing a pretty good job of it. Caleb says that he's confused, but Cornelia can't see how anything is more complicated now than it was when they met. But Caleb does, because according to him, he thought he knew Cornelia. And then it turned out there was this whole other girl! He tells Cornelia that this isn't who she really is, that he fell in love with someone who doesn't exist. Which is utterly pathetic. She's the same person, she just doesn't have wings. And he already met her in her human form! He knows exactly who she is, I hate everything about this so much, it's so fucking stupid. He's literally saying he doesn't like her because she looks slightly different to how she did when they met. It's like dumping someone because they don't look as pretty without their makeup on or because they gained weight. It's the most shallow bullshit I've ever heard, and it makes it impossible to see Caleb as anything other than a complete fuckboy at this point. Caleb says that they are too different and that this is the right choice. Cornelia points out that she didn't get a choice. She says that she thought he was different, but she was wrong. She tells him it's too late to try and hug her and that she won't cry, that it's not a big deal, it's just goodbye. We then see her run through and throw herself into Will's arms because that's who she should be dating instead of Plant Boy. Caleb goes to speak to the Oracle and they have a heart-to-heart of sorts. The Guardians are then tasked with escorting Caleb back to Meridian, but Irma says she would rather escort a dozen skunks and Cornelia asks to be excused from the mission. The Oracle agrees and Cornelia returns to Heatherfield whilst Irma tells Caleb that she wants to kick him back to Meridian, which is hilarious. An icon, I would also like to kick Caleb. Caleb goes back to Meridian and reunites with Elyon, who, once again, he has way more chemistry with than he ever did with Cornelia. Elyon is confused as to why the girls are suddenly so hostile towards Caleb, but they decide not to tell her and spoil her day. And that's it. That's the end of the relationship between Cornelia and Caleb. But whilst they never get back together, their relationship is brought up again in Arc 3. Water shadows is such a weird issue and really sets the tone for how messy Arc 3 will become. Irma meets this old man who can predict the future for some reason and he gives Irma predictions about her friends. It's strange. Irma passes on the message from Jewel to Cornelia that she should start ice skating again to get over her breakup with Caleb. Cornelia responds by yelling that if she did want to talk about Caleb, it would not be with Irma. Later we hear from Irma that Cornelia has taken up ice skating again and that is helping her block out the bad thoughts. But then we cut to Cornelia and it seems that that couldn't be further from the truth. Instead, she stares at Caleb's drawing and wonders if she'll ever have the strength to rip it up. What we do see from this is that at this point, Cornelia does want to move on. She's, you know, imagining a future where she has the ability to forget about Caleb, to rip up this photo and to move on with her life. But by issue 29, she seems to have gone back to missing him again. We see Caleb in the cover art of issue 29 along with Rick, a boy who is interested in Cornelia, and of course Cornelia. The quote says, "Why? Why am I not in Meridian with him?" Which tells us that we are going back into the nightmare that is this relationship. Cornelia, Tarani and Helen are at Redstone Academy for reasons. I'm not going into the arc 3 plot lines, I'll lose my mind. Tarani says that she misses Nigel and that she wishes she could be with him, which causes Cornelia to walk off sadly. Helen starts talking about Eric before Tarani notices Cornelia leaving. Cornelia excuses herself and smiles, saying she needs to go back to the room, but as she turns away, we see her crying. Tarani realises that it's because they're talking about their boyfriends, who they will see again when they return to Heatherfield, but of course, Cornelia doesn't have a boyfriend to go back to. The boy that she loves is on another world, and he's never coming back. As she walks away, a boy comes running up to her. But Cornelia is very cold to him and brushes off his advances. When he won't give up, she launches a frisbee at him, which is kind of baller, I'm not gonna lie. She then goes to the cliffside and wonders, why are there only idiots on Earth? Why am I not in Meridian with him? Girl, I can tell you why. It's because he dumped you. He told you that he didn't want you to come to Meridian with him, and he dumped you. He dumped you because you didn't have wings. I feel like you've forgotten that part. It's not like fate ripped you apart. It's not like it's Doctor Who and she flew through the Doomsday Portal. He just straight up dumped your ass and you called him a worm. But whatever, have your sunset cliffside moment. We then transition to Meridian, where we see Caleb and Elyon. The narration tells us that Caleb is thinking about Cornelia. Elyon has a decision to make, and Caleb tells her that life is full of choices and that sometimes you have to choose the lesser evil. And at that point, we see a picture of Cornelia in the background. That's kind of funny because he's basically saying that, like, being on Meridian is the lesser evil, which implies that being with Cornelia would be being with Cornelia is a worse evil. I had to break up with Cornelia because that was the less evil than being with her. Like, boy, what? This fucking relationship. The Lesser Evil was released in August 2003, and 3 months later, a special issue was released. And it was, of course, Cornelia and Caleb, A Love Not Meant to Be. Before I even get into it, we need to talk about the cover of this issue. Like, I don't even like Cornelia and Caleb, and yet I'm desperate to own a physical copy of this issue because look at it. Look at the design! It's just so pretty! The drama! I love it. This special really felt like it was closing the door on the Cornelia and Caleb relationship. It's unique amongst the Witch issues that it was double-sided, with one side telling Caleb's story and the other telling Cornelia's. And as such, I don't think it really matters what way you read them, so I'm going to start with Cornelia's story because I think it's the less interesting of the two. The story opens up in Kanjikar with the Oracle expressing regret for the pain that both Cornelia and Caleb are still feeling after their breakup. He decides to use Cornelia and Caleb's dreams to show them that they made the right choice breaking up and that their relationship would never have worked out no matter what they did. Which I think is quite poetic, really. Obviously, their relationship began in their dreams and now the door is finally closing on it in their dreams. It has started and ended in dreams. And that's kind of cool. We pick up in Kanjikar where Caleb is breaking up with Cornelia, except this time, Cornelia makes a decision to go to Metamur with him, stating that she loves him more than anything and she always will. Gag. The girls are shocked and ask how she can abandon them, her family, her life. But she just keeps saying she loves Caleb and she's made her choice. Her astral drop will take over her life and she will give up her powers. The Oracle agrees and revokes her powers, but leaves her in her older form. Well, that's lucky, since Caleb made it quite clear that he doesn't like her younger form. What a perceptive man the Oracle is, dearie me. Cornelia says goodbye to her friends and goes to Metamur, where she reunites with Elyon, and for a while, things are great. Elyon gives Cornelia a room in the palace, she rides horses through the fields with Caleb, and stays up late swapping secrets with Elyon by the fire. Everything seems perfect. But after a while, she finds herself thinking about her old life. She tries to squash it down, but she can't. She's beginning to doubt the choice that she made. She's homesick. Caleb says that he knows what a huge sacrifice she made for him and how he isn't sure that he could have done the same. Yeah, we know, bro. You dumped her. He says he wants to help her and he knows a way. It's called the Laren solution. It's a potion that wipes your memories. Cornelia would start all over from the moment she drank the potion. No memories of Earth or her family or friends. Just Caleb, Elyon, and Metamur. Elyon and Caleb leave the room and leave Cornelia alone with the potion. From then on, Cornelia is happy and free, enjoying her new life with Caleb. But then, a blast from the past shows up to shatter her equilibrium. The other guardians arrive at the palace to visit, but of course Cornelia does not remember them. The girls are horrified that she would give up her memories and that no one told them about it, and they're determined to restore Cornelia's memory. But then the truth comes out. Cornelia never drank the Laren solution. She was just pretending to forget, to protect her heart. But the truth is, she spent every single second thinking about the world that she left behind and everything that she lost. She realizes now that she can't stay in Metamur, and Caleb says that this is not the life that she was looking for. The Oracle states that the choice that Cornelia made for love had devastating consequences, risking losing the friends that meant so much to her. And so she returned to her old life and resigned herself to only ever seeing Caleb in her dreams. And so we see that Cornelia moving to Metamur to be with Caleb could never work. It seemed like a perfect life to start with, but she could never get over the pain of everything and everyone that she left behind. And in the end, her love for her friends and her family and her world was stronger than her love for Caleb, and she had no choice but to leave him behind forever. Caleb's side of the story is similar, except in his version, it's him who makes the choice to leave his life behind and move to another planet. We're on Kanjikar on that fateful day, and Caleb is still totally confused about what to do about Cornelia. He still feels like she's two different people, the Guardian and the Earth Girl. But when he sees how upset she is, he makes a split-second decision and says that he'll go to Heatherfield with her. He hopes that this will allow him to get to know the real Cornelia and that everything will fall into place. I think it's interesting as well that he's very much not sure about this decision. It's something that he says in the spur of the moment, purely because he feels so guilty about making Cornelia cry, whereas Cornelia was completely, wholeheartedly, I will go to Meridian, I will give up everything, I will do anything to be with you. Whereas he's clearly not sure about this. He still doesn't really know what he wants to do, and he really only agrees to go to Heatherfield. Kind of, I'm not even sure he really means to. I think he just kind of says it, like literally just blurts it out, and then like from that moment on really questions if that was the right thing to do. So he clearly is not as invested in this relationship as she was, even at this point. Like, she had her whole heart in this, and he did not. Anyway, the girls help Caleb settle on Earth. They bring him clothes, and Cornelia uses magic to remove his green stripes, which apparently was an option all along, so that was never an issue, never mind. But where's he going to live? Cornelia suggests Elyon's abandoned home, but Will thinks that that's a bad idea. This causes the rest of the group to leave Cornelia and Caleb alone at the house, and the Oracle says that something has shifted within the group. But already Caleb is having doubts. He has a house, but it's not his. He doesn't have a surname or an identity here. He knows that to be able to buy things you need money, but how can he get that? He says he wants a real life, not this. But Cornelia assures him that it's only temporary while she gets him set up, but she warns him not to go into the city without her, and Caleb says that that's just like being a prisoner. So he decides to head out and find a job, wanting to prove to Cornelia that he can take care of himself. He's the rebel leader after all, but of course he can't. He has no experience and no documentation. He tells Cornelia that he does not believe he will ever belong on Earth. She's the only thing that he has here, and that maybe he made the wrong choice. And then chaos ensues. Caleb and Cornelia are spotted at the abandoned house and arrested. Caleb can't provide any information about who he is or where he came from, and then he makes the mistake of saying that he's a friend of Elyon Brown, the same Elyon Brown who's still recorded as a missing person in Heatherfield. Caleb is put in a police van to be transferred to another department, and Cornelia decides her only option is to attack the vehicle and rescue him. The rest of the girls show up to help, but as they're making their escape, the officer shoots Irma's wing and she collapses. When she transforms back into her normal self, the guardians are exposed to the world. Caleb has to go on the run, and without Cornelia's magic to conceal his stripes, he has to hide away from all humanity, whilst the fate of the Guardians is left uncertain, and the only place that Caleb could ever find refuge was in his dreams. And so we see that Caleb moving to Earth would have been a ding-dang disaster. Everyone is arrested, Irma almost died, Caleb's living alone in the woods, having a miserable existence. The amount of chaos that this boy causes is beyond belief. And thus, Cornelia and Caleb truly are a love not meant to be. But see, that's the thing. That's what makes this issue so good. It's because it quite clearly shows that their relationship was doomed from the start. They were never going to work. In both versions, not only can they not adjust to each other's world, but they end up fighting. There's conflict between them. They would never work because they just truly are too different in every possible way. And no amount of love could ever change that. So why did we bother doing the whole "you don't always look like this" nonsense? This was a perfectly good explanation, a much better explanation. You should have just done this from the beginning. Ugh, it annoys me so much. It's such a stupid reason to break up with her, and I think part of, if not all of, the reason that this issue exists is just to show that there was a bigger issue there, because I think they knew that the fans had not taken that reasoning well, so they had to do something to prove that Cornelia and Caleb wouldn't have worked even if Caleb wasn't a shallow idiot. Back in arc 3, in issue 34, Cornelia, Helen and Trelawney have returned to Heatherfield, but weird things are happening. The girls keep doing things but then having no recollection of having done them. Irma wrote nonsense in a test but can't remember why. Trelawney shouts at Nigel but doesn't know why. And Cornelia makes a mushy phone call to Rick from Redstone but has no memory of doing so or any idea of why she did it. And she discusses this bizarre phenomenon with Will. Cornelia is confused and kind of upset because she knows that she doesn't love Rick, but Will has another view of the situation. She tells Cornelia that she's finally starting to move on from Caleb, and that she called Rick in an attempt to return to her old, not heartbroken self. But then she felt guilty about it and tried. But then she felt guilty about moving on and tried to block out the memory. She's wrong, but Cornelia thinks that it makes sense and accepts this as the reason. Of course, in reality, it's because the girls are being influenced by the memories of their astral drops, who, by this point, are completely different people from the girls themselves. But that's a discussion for another day. The point is that Cornelia agrees that maybe she really is beginning to get over Caleb. Jumping forward to arc 4 now. Caleb and Elyon return to the story in this arc as Elyon is asked to renounce her crown by the new oracle. But before the girls go to Metamoor to investigate that, we see Cornelia thinking about Caleb in the school hallway. The Grumpers are making fun of Cornelia, saying that someone would have to custom build her a boyfriend because she's so fussy. Or that she'll have to date a green-skinned alien, which causes Cornelia to think about Caleb for the first time in a while. But for once, she doesn't remember him with pain or sadness or anger or regret. Instead, she can barely recall his face or voice, showing that she has finally moved on from him. Unfortunately, his face and voice are going to become all too familiar for her very soon, as later in the issue, the girls travel to Metamoor with orders to arrest Elyon, which brings Cornelia face to face with Caleb for the first time since their breakup. It's rather awkward. We get these shots of them having to hold hands to form a circle on one of the later pages. It just feels very uncomfortable. And then later, everyone is having dinner and discussing the plan to protect Elyon when Cornelia reveals that she and Caleb have an idea. The girls are immediately cautious and afraid that Cornelia is going to fall for Caleb again, and between everything that happened and the fact that they strongly suspect that he has feelings for Elyon, they don't want her to get hurt. But Cornelia tells them not to worry, that she and Caleb have decided that they can still be good friends in spite of everything that went down between them. And honestly, this makes me so happy because regardless of how stupid their love story was, they clearly cared for each other a great deal. And as I said, the only reason that Caleb even has a human form and isn't spending his days sitting in a vase is because of Cornelia. I feel like the least that they deserve is to be able to have some kind of a friendship with each other. Which I feel like they would have been able to do if he hadn't dumped her for such a stupid reason. If they hadn't written it like that, they could have been friends. But no, they had to write it the way that they did. Ugh, ugh. In the next issue, we see Caleb wandering the halls of the Meridian Palace thinking about Elyon. But his thoughts of Elyon cause him to think about Cornelia. He reminisces on what it was like to see her again, and about how, whilst he still holds a special place in his heart for her, he knows now that all they are is friends. A friend to whom he entrusted the person who means the most to him. His queen. You know what? Making this video has really confirmed to me that I'm actually Caleb and Elyon trash. This is so cute, and the fact that Cornelia is nothing but happy for them is just so sweet. I love it. Caleb and Cornelia briefly meet up in the next issue and she puts her hand on his shoulder, but that's pretty much it, so I'm just going to skip over it. They also work together for a few pages of the final issue of this arc, but honestly it's more Will Cornelia content than anything else, so again, skipping it. In March 2007, a special issue was released focusing on the lives of Caleb and Elyon on Metamoor. The art style is odd and the plot is more odd. I'm not going to dive into the story in this video because this isn't the Caleb and Elyon timeline, it's the Cornelia and Caleb timeline, but there are some scenes in here which are relevant. Elyon is stuck in this sort of magical coma, but Tarani can hear her thoughts, and she hears Elyon asking Cornelia to forgive her for being in love with Caleb. Cornelia is shocked and leaves the room, but outside she questions why she feels like this. Her feelings for Caleb are gone, so why does she feel so jealous? Eventually, Elyon wakes up, but she's heartbroken to find that Caleb is gone, that he'd sacrificed himself to save her. Cornelia tries to encourage her, and Elyon apologises, asking Cornelia not to hate her. Cornelia asks why she would ever hate her. She and Caleb broke up a long time ago, and she admits that while at first she was hurt, she felt like a monster for feeling that way. And besides, she has someone new in her life anyway. Peter. Eventually, Caleb returns in one piece, and Halen tells Elyon the good news. She's thrilled, but feels uncomfortable expressing it in front of Cornelia, but Cornelia tells Elyon to go to him, and they hug it out. Cornelia tells Will that she's fine and that it's time to go home, leaving Elyon with the man that she loves and proving that she is truly over Caleb for good, and proving that I am Caleb and Elyon trash because this is so damn cute! Moving all the way on to arc 7 now, although this issue actually only came out 5 months after the Caleb and Elyon special, but it's not entirely clear when in the timeline the Caleb and Elyon special is supposed to happen. Like, it feels like it must be more around arc 4, but I don't know. Anyway, by this point in the series, Cornelia is fully committed to her relationship with Peter, and in this issue, she decides to tell him about her previous heartbreak. Cornelia feels jealous after having found pictures of Peter's exes, but she's mad at herself for it, and it makes her reflect on her relationship with Caleb. Cornelia tells Peter that she loved Caleb very much, but that their relationship is over forever. Peter then pulls Cornelia into a photo booth to take pictures, and she considers how different her love with Peter is to what she had with Caleb. She says that with Peter she can be silly and fun, which is so unlike her. She's willing to take photos with him even though she looks a mess. She doesn't think of Caleb anymore. He only ever saw one version of her, and he didn't like the real her. But Peter saw her at her lowest, and he still wanted to be with her. Which is the exact reverse of what happens in the show, which is why Cornelia and Caleb are endgame there, and Cornelia and Peter aren't. Do you see? I'm done of having this conversation with people when they're like, but they broke up in the comics, and she has to end up with Peter. No. 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 The storyline is the same. The characters are swapped. So if you want her to end up with Peter, what you're actually saying is you want her to end up with Caleb. I don't make the rules. And so we see how Peter is absolutely the better person for her here, and how Cornelia can now see that her relationship with Caleb was not a good one. She realises now how much better off she is without him. We now jump all the way forward to arc 10, and one of my favourite Cornelia moments of the entire series. Will is upset after having a fight with Matt, as usual, and Cornelia goes to speak to her. She wants to tell Will about how she felt after her breakup with Caleb and how she feels now, to show Will that hearts can in fact heal. I love this page so much. It has taken 8 arcs, but we finally have Cornelia acknowledging that the fact that her and Caleb met in her dreams means absolutely nothing. And honestly, I feel like the writers never really put any thought into that. Like, they met in their dreams, but why? What was the reason? Why did Cornelia have this psychic link to Caleb? Because ultimately they got together not out of genuine feelings for each other, but because they felt like they should because they met in their dreams. But after that very first issue where Caleb is introduced, the dream thing is never really acknowledged again, except for in the special issue when, you know, the Oracle makes them see them in their dreams. And so it just makes me so happy to see that Cornelia here is finally realizing that no, they weren't meant to be together just because they saw each other in a dream. She just thought they were. She also acknowledges how reckless she was in wanting to give up her entire life on Earth to be with him, and how devastating it was when he rejected her. But now she has Peter, and she sees now that just because your heart has been broken doesn't mean that it can't heal. It can still love again. And that it's okay to give up on a relationship that's not working and to pursue a new relationship with someone else. Sometimes you have to let go of the person you thought was the one in order to find the person who actually is. And on that note, Will should have dumped Matt and got together with Nash, and I'll also die on that hill. Arc 11 now, and the Guardians are on Kanjikar when Elyon and Caleb teleport in. And Cornelia does this when she sees Caleb. Now, this whole scene is bizarre. I'm not sure if it's a translation issue or if the writers just lost the plot here, being that we don't have an official English release of Arc 11 thanks to Yen Press not finishing the reprints, but this is what it says in the version that I have. I truly have no idea why Caleb asks how long have we loved each other. Not for literal years at this point? You dumped her and your date Nellion? What in Metamur are you talking about? But other than that, it's a sweet moment showing that they still have their friendship bond. But yeah, I found everything about that line weird. Like, you're not together anymore. You have not been for a very long time. Issue 139, the final issue. The Guardians have passed all the tests and are now ready to become magical sovereigns, and so everyone goes to Kanjikar to celebrate. Elyon shows the girls flashes from their years as Guardians, including Caleb and Cornelia kissing, which is a weird thing to show as when it's a picture of your boyfriend kissing his ex, who's also your best friend, but there we are. Caleb arrives and we get one final moment of him and Cornelia together, smiling. And that's it! That's the entire timeline of Cornelia and Caleb's relationship and the aftermath thereof in the comics. And yeah, I still hate it. Now, I haven't scripted a conclusion to this video because I kind of wanted to just riff and just tell you my kind of overall thoughts on this couple after having gone through it. And it has been a really interesting journey to actually sit and break it all down like this, because it's something that I've never done. Like, I know I hate this couple, but to actually go through it like page by page, line by line, and actually kind of break down everything, like everything that's ever happened, and to look into especially the aftermath of their relationship, which I think is actually more interesting than the relationship itself. Like, there's, I think that's where it does get really interesting, because showing the fans, you know, that you can get over your first big breakup, you know, because that's a really formative moment in your life when you have your first great love and then your first great heartbreak. And it shows them, you know, that like Cornelia says, hearts can heal and you can move on. And sometimes the person that you think is the one for you isn't. And sometimes, you know, you need to accept that a relationship sometimes is supposed to end. Even if it feels completely wrong to you at the time, sometimes relationships are supposed to end. And only by ending that relationship and accepting the end of their relationship can you move on to something better. And so I think that's good. It's still not a well-written relationship, though. I mean, the fact that I think that the more interesting part comes from after they break up than their actual relationship is quite telling. What baffles me is the fact that this is still considered to be one of the best ships in the comic. And there are still people to this day. To be fair, last night I went down a bit of a rabbit hole. I decided to go and look up the really old Cornelia and Caleb fan videos I used to watch. Some of them, the oldest ones on YouTube right now, are 17 years old. And I like watched them when they were uploaded, so that makes me feel old as hell. I found the one, I actually burst out laughing because I found the one that was set to Miracle by Cascada. And I was like, I used to watch this video all the time. And I still, when I love that song, whenever I listen to it, that's all I can see in my head is that video. But I still saw people in the comments talking about like how much they hated the fact that these two broke up in the comics. And I'm like, how? Because they're so bad. And I've been thinking it myself while I've been working on this. I'm like, why did this couple have such a chokehold on the fans when they are so poorly written and there's no substance to their relationship and they barely have any scenes together before they break up? Because the majority of the time it's Cornelia sitting around on Earth going, wah, 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 I'm sad about Caleb. Sad because he's a plant. Sad because he's being captured. Sad because she forgot him. Like, the actual time that they spend in the same room together is so minimal. And I was like, why do these two have this chokehold on the fan base when they're so bad? Because growing up, because I started with the comics and then went to the show and then came back to the comics, I of course became a massive Cornelia and Caleb fan in the show, and so I felt like I was obligated to like them in the comics. And then when I read the comics, I was like, I don't like these two together. And I felt like I was wrong for that. And I kept thinking to myself, I'm like, what am I missing? But I wasn't. I just didn't like them. I was just like, I don't feel anything for this. There's nothing here. There's no, like, it's not, and I am like the biggest shipper. You know me, you can give me the most shite content for a ship and I'll ship it because I am a hopeless romantic. It's who I am. I am Taylor Swift incarnate. Like, I love romance. And I was getting nothing from these two. And I was like, why are they so popular? But I was thinking about it, and I think it only really came to me the other night, and I think it is the fairy tale-ness, because I keep describing them as having a fairy tale love. And what I mean by that isn't that it's, like, good. I mean, it feels otherworldly. It feels like something from a fairy tale. But fairy tale loves are quite often not, in and of themselves, like, particularly good relationship. Look at, like, think of, like, Enchanted and how, like, she and the prince think they're supposed to be together, but the prince is not the man for her. It's Patrick Dempsey. Or how, like, Anna thinks that she's in love with Hans, but Hans is messing with her and she's actually supposed to be with Kristoff. You know, just because something feels fairy tale doesn't mean that it's legit. But I think what it is if you think about every other relationship in the comics, Matt and Will, Helen and Eric, Tarani and Nigel, Irma and Joel, it's all, they're dating the boys that they met at school. That's the basis of all of their relationships, is girl, main girl, and boy from school. Cornelia and Caleb's the only one that breaks that mold. And I think that's what was interesting, was the fact that he was from another world. The fact that they, I mean, whatever, they met in their dreams. I don't think that's interesting, but some people do. But the fact that they were from two different worlds, the fact that they had, he played a part in the actual story, not a very good one, but, like, he's there, he's on Kandakar, he's getting captured by Nerissa, like, he's involved in the story, he's on Meridian, he's friends with Elyon, like, he's tied to the main plot. And I think that's why people gravitated towards that, because it stood out, it was different, it was unique. And the only other relationship in the series that ever actually played on that again was Will and Nashtar, and it doesn't go anywhere. But other than that, every boy that they date is just a boy from the town. Irma and Steven, Tarani and Luke, sort of, when they had a bit of a thing, or Hamza, who she meets at, like, a camp or something, I don't know, Helen and Vincent, like, they're all just guys from the town. The only, like, well, ignoring the fact that Matt turns out to be a whole Kandakar agent thing, ignoring that, we don't talk about that. He wasn't for six arcs. Every other boy in the series is just a regular guy. So the fact that Caleb was not a regular guy, I think, is part of why this was so interesting to people. But it's not well written. It's not good. And they aren't enjoyable. But I think that's where it comes from. And I have to say, I do respect them for keeping that in the show. Because I think conceptually it does make sense of having this girl fall in love with a boy from another planet. That's part of why I enjoy Cornelia and Caleb so much in the show. I think that's an interesting dynamic, you know? Except in the TV show, they actually made it work, because they made the characters, they made the characters more likable, and they made their relationship not feel like nonsense. It actually evolves from, like, a friendship into a relationship, and they go through turmoil and they work it out themselves, and they learn and they grow and they evolve, instead of just being, we are in love because we are. And this is something I think is really interesting. This only came to me recently, and I want to tell you about it. So very recently I was watching a video. I will get the link, I will credit it. I can't remember the name of the YouTuber at the moment, but I will find it and I'll link it in the description or put it on the screen or something. And it was a video about the relationship between the Doctor and River Song. And I hate that relationship. I hate River Song. I know that's a really unpopular opinion. I find her incredibly annoying. I find their relationship completely boring, and I hate it, and I hate everything about it. And it's not because I'm a Rose Tyler stan, I just don't like it. I just don't. And I saw this video, and it was like talking, I could see that it was about, like, a negative view of this relationship, and I was like, oh, that's interesting, because pretty much everyone I know loves River and the Doctor. I wonder why this person feels differently. I'm intrigued to hear what they have to say. So I watched it, and he was talking, and he was saying that the reason that he doesn't think that the relationship between the Doctor and River is a good relationship is because they don't get any say in being in that relationship. He says that River, the first time that the Doctor meets River is the last time that River meets the Doctor. It's because, if you've never seen it, their timeline, they're both time travelers, but their timelines run in opposite directions to each other. So the Doctor meets River in the library, and she is at the end of her timeline, and she tells him that she, like, they have this connection, you know, and he realizes like they must have this big, like, deep love later in his life. And then, of course, at the other end of the timeline, the last time that the Doctor meets River, which is the first time that the River meets him, same thing happens, where it's like he has to tell her, like, we are going to go on to have this big relationship later in your life. But as a result, what that means is that they never actually get any say in being together, because they think that they have to, because they've been told by each other at the other end of their timelines that they are supposed to be together. So the only reason that they choose to, the only reason that they end up together, the only reason that they enter into a relationship is because they think that they have to, because they've been told by the other one in the future that they had a relationship in their past. So they think that because they think that because obviously the timeline is so important to the time travelers, they're like, well, I have to be in a relationship with him because he told me that we are in my future. Or for the Doctor, like, we have to be in a relationship because she told me that we are in my future. And they both think that at opposite ends of their timeline. So when they meet in the middle, they're like, well, we need to be in a relationship. But they don't actually ever form what feels like a real connection with each other. They're just in it because they feel like they have to, because they've been told. And I was like, when I was watching the video, I was like, oh my god, that's it exactly. Not that's it about the Doctor and River Song, although that's true. I was like, that's what it is about Cornelia and Caleb. It's the fact that they never actually form a connection to each other. They just think that they're supposed to be together because they met each other in their dreams, which is what Cornelia herself says in issue 128. She says, I thought we were supposed to be together because we met in our dreams. But it's like, that's the whole problem, is that, and I remember I saw someone online who said, like, that they thought that that was, I've seen multiple people say that, like, the thought that they met in their dreams is, like, so romantic. But it's not, because it doesn't achieve anything. We don't know what happens in their dreams. What we do know is when they meet in person, they don't actually form any kind of connection with each other, any bond. We don't see them having any meaningful conversations. They just exist in each other's orbit and claim to be in love. And it's so surface level that it's just impossible to care. And I'm just, that's what really bugs me, is the fact that they never actually made a conscious choice to be in a relationship. They just are in one because they think that they're supposed to be because of their dreams. Cornelia thinks she's in love with Caleb because she dreamt about him, therefore he's her soulmate. She's not in love with him. She's in love with an idea of him. And he's in love with an idea of her. They aren't fully fledged people to each other. They are concepts. They are each in love with the concept of the other, the idea of the other. But they never actually fall in love as two individual people with each other. And that is my issue with this relationship. So I don't like it. And I've never liked it. I didn't like it as a kid, and I don't like it now. I like it even less now. My voice is going. I've been ranting about this for so long. Oh my god, I can't talk. This is what you've done to me, comic Cornelia and Caleb. You've broken my throat. But yeah, that's ultimately my feelings about these two. I don't like them together. I love them together in the show, but, and I sometimes I get really kind of frustrated having to try and explain this, because it's really hard to try and explain that my, like, most favourite ship of all time is Cornelia and Caleb, and that I hate Cornelia and Caleb. It's really hard to explain to people who either aren't in the fandom or are only on, have only ever engaged with one section of the Witch franchise. So they're either TV show people or they're comic book people, but they're not both. It's really hard to try and explain. Especially, I think, with the Cornelia and Caleb, with the comic fans, the comic-only fans, because I'll say, like, oh, I love Cornelia and Caleb in the TV show, and people will be like, but they were so awful, he broke up with her, and it's like, they're not, it's not the same, the story isn't the same, it's completely different, he's a completely different character, they're not the same. Or you see people making, like, Cornelia and Caleb fan art, and people are like, why would you do that? She's meant to be with Peter. It's like, it's not the same, they're not the same characters. So this is the bane of my existence. Being a Cornelia and Caleb TV show fan and a Cornelia and Caleb comic hater is the bane of my existence. But yeah, I think that's all I have to say on it. I hope you enjoyed this. I do apologize if you do still ship these two. You're obviously entitled to do so. I would never tell anyone not to ship something. Enjoy what you enjoy, like what you like. But personally, I just can't with them. I never have been able to can with them. I think the writers really screwed up writing these two. I think there probably could have been something interesting there. I think there absolutely could have. I think there was definitely potential here for these two to not be the worst couple ever. But they definitely fumbled the bag because they have no bond. They have no scenes together. And then he dumps her for a reason that doesn't make sense in the story, because it contradicts what we've already seen, and it makes him just sound like a shallow idiot. So it's just really poorly written is the issue. But yeah, that's all I have for you today. Thank you for watching, and tell me what you think about Cornelia and Caleb in the comics in the comments below, and I'll see you in the next one. And I'm away off to like swallow a soother or something because I've just lost my voice. See you next time, everyone.